Exploring White Fragility, Debating the Effects of Whiteness Studies on America's Schools. Preface. Not all whites are racially illiterate. Robin DiAngelo, whose white fragility theory has become one of the most influential ideas about racism in America, believes the majority of whites in America are racially illiterate. In her book, What Does It Mean to Be White? Developing White Racial Literacy, she describes how it's taken her years of intensive study and practice to be able to recognize how her life has been shaped by race, and goes on to list many of the advantages of being white, writing that although she is speaking for herself, it is a rare white person who cannot recognize most of the privileges I identify. She begins with a section titled Belonging, and explains how she was born into a culture where she was accepted racially, and how even where she was born and the conditions surrounding her birth were shaped by race, that the all-white hospital in the all-white neighborhood, filled with the all-white mothers nursing their all-white babies, socialized her into believing whiteness was normal, free from race, and that being white was associated with acceptance, privilege, and the luxury of not having to think about skin color. Curiously, my birth was the total opposite. My mother was 19 when she had me, and my father was a 21-year-old education student at Temple University. Recently married, they were renting a 900-square-foot row house in southwest Philadelphia and had no health insurance. When my mother went into labor 5 days before Christmas in 1971, my father took her to what was then Misericordia Hospital at 54th and Cedar in the predominantly African-American section of West Philadelphia, a healthcare facility that had a government-subsidized maternity clinic. My mom knew immediately that they were in an all-black neighborhood as she saw the black Santa Clauses decorating the houses and lawns. As they drove through the streets, my mom remembered feeling very aware of being white, as people on street corners and in SEPTA buses gave her extended glances and hard looks, wondering what her and my father were doing in their neighborhood. She recalled the same experience as she sat in the waiting room of the hospital, as many of the patients were black. And when my mom gave birth to me and was recovering on the maternity ward and doting over me in the nursery, she remembered the stares of the black women and recalled one of them commenting, "What is this skinny white girl doing here?" Granted, this was 1971, a much angrier time in America, where racial tension was overt and personal, not simply implicit or systemic. To my parents' credit, they never became bitter or harbored any racial resentment. In fact, just the opposite. My father became a school teacher at John Bartram High School in the increasingly diverse neighborhood of Southwest Philadelphia, teaching business and coaching track and cross country. At this time, we lived in Yaden, Pennsylvania, a small suburb of Philadelphia. And when the neighborhood started to change demographically, when families from West Philly started to move into the area, my parents stayed put. When gang activity over a turf dispute started as a result, they stuck it out. When fights and violence erupted, they tried to stay positive. It wasn't until I was assaulted outside the Yaden movie theater that my parents considered moving. It was for safety reasons, my dad insisted. When we finally did leave the neighborhood the summer before my freshman year in high school, I was beside myself. I was convinced my parents wanted to leave because all my friends were black and because I'd completely fallen in love with this budding new cultural phenomenon called hip-hop, obsessing over rap music, breakdancing, graffiti art, and Run DMC. Despite the move, I turned out okay. I became a Philadelphia public school teacher and track coach like my father. Students in my English classes have gone on to graduate college and become psychologists, teachers, business owners, and computer programmers. In 2015, a former pupil of mine graduated the United States Air Force Academy. On the track, my athletes have won Penn Relays medals, PIAA state track and field championships, and have been awarded multiple academic and athletic scholarships. In total, I've spent 2 decades working and interacting with teenagers and parents of all races and ethnic backgrounds in Philadelphia classrooms, on ball fields, and in the basements of churches. I'm also a certified secondary school counselor with an MED in multicultural education. I've read and studied Freire, Kozel, McIntosh, Fagan, Tatum, Banks, Helms, Frankenberg, Takaki, and multiple other scholars and researchers. And of course, I've read and studied Robin DiAngelo, whose life and upbringing, though in some ways very similar, is worlds apart from mine. I draw a parallel to D'Angelo's life, not to deny whites have a systemic societal advantage over people of color, or to deny that my early life experiences were contextual and that they took place in the microculture as opposed to the macroculture, but to show that D'Angelo's worldview is only a perspective of the whole and should not be viewed as infallible or universally correct. I have a different insight into the dynamics of race and race relations, and these insights shouldn't be written off as ignorant or illiterate. Yet too often they are. I have attended scores of anti-bias workshops over the past 23 years, including one on white fragility headed by Robin DiAngelo, and have witnessed the usual patterns of Orwellian indoctrination emerge from facilitators and professors. They are always the same. Any deviation from the anti-racist framework is an ideological violation that cannot be tolerated. Hence, the white participant is told that they are racially illiterate, uninformed or misinformed, or simply speaking from opinion. Their perspectives and worldviews are rendered invalid, and finally, it is insinuated that they are perpetuating racism. But generalizing about whites in this manner is unhealthy and counterproductive. And it is not the best way to bring about positive change. As a longtime Philadelphia school teacher and coach, I'd like to expand the conversation to include viewpoints from all races and ethnic backgrounds and have a true open dialogue as opposed to a rigid ideological monologue. A tolerant, holistic approach to diversity, equity, and inclusion must be achieved to create the kinds of schools needed to educate all of America's children.